Hey everyone, Alyssa Lightman here with Realty One Group Dockside, and welcome back to The Lightman Show. Make sure you give this video a like, subscribe, and share with friends and family. And you can also leave your comments and questions below for us to talk about in the next episode. Understanding market analysis. So the market analysis is a comprehensive report that agents prepare for their homeowners to explain to them and show them what their home could sell for and how it compares to other properties that sold in the last 6 months, 6 to 12 months, basically. Have you guys had to work with market analysis, or
My only experience with one of those is actually it was a probate case, mm-hmm. and that we were trying to get permission for the estate owner to sell the property. And one of the things that we have to do is get a market analysis mm-hmm. from an agent mm-hmm. so that we can show the court this is what we believe it will sell for. And so it was pretty interesting though to take a look at it, you know, mm-hmm. and see the properties that the property is compared to and things like that. So I would say they're certainly helpful.
They're pretty specific, right? Sure. Tell you all these things, you know, the half bath and the flooring and right. the comparables to everything.
The only time I've experienced having to get a market analysis is when the appraisal value came in later. Mm. So then you want to get the agents to get together to find different comps mm-hmm. that would rebut the actual appraisal. So it's good to know that market and have an agent that can dive in and really get in and then find other comps that are in the same neighborhood. I had one that it was just a school district. Mm-hmm. It was on a borderline, but if the house, the comp that they used was on the side with the good school district, mm-hmm. But the house was actually on the other side of that line. So just knowing that information helped bring that value in to where it needed to be versus not. So
yeah, not being in that school
it's one of those things where a good agent would be able to pick that part up.
Right. Oh, net mm-hmm. proceeds, taxes, and prorations.
So that sounds like a question for me.
Yes, it does.
It does. So the net proceeds, the listing agent also does prepare something for their sellers just to give them an idea of what their costs are going to be and what their net may be, because sure. we don't know how much the home is going to sell for. Right. We don't know what the closing costs are going to be and the little details in there. But what about the prorations and all the other right. details?
So taxes and prorations. We basically, here in South Carolina, we pay our taxes in arrears. And so, if you were selling today, the last tax bill that we would have to go by would be for 2018. Mm-hmm. And so we would pull that tax bill, we would put that into the computer. The computer does its magic and tells us exactly how much the seller should pay for their share of 2019 from January until today being the day of the sale. And then from the day of the sale to December 31st, 2019, at that point, then that's the buyer's expense. So the seller gives the buyer X amount of dollars for their time that they've owned the property. And then the buyer has to pay the remaining bill when the bill comes due. So the bill is paid by the buyer for the whole amount because they've already gotten the seller's share.
The mm-hmm. homeowner doesn't pay for the whole year.
Right.
It gets prorated. Sure. They get their money back on that. They also get their money back on things like insurance, right? Mm-hmm.
So HOAs would be mm-hmm. another good one. So if the seller has paid for July HOA dues and they sell on the 15th of the month, then the buyer will be giving them back 15 days of July, yeah. and the buyer will most likely also pay August and September HOA dues in advance. And then you said something else. What was the other thing you mentioned?
What was the other thing? It was, let's see, taxes, prorations, net proceeds. That's about it.
Okay.
Prorations, net okay. proceeds.
Insurance. Yes, that's what it was. Insurance. So the seller is not going to get their insurance money back on the settlement statement. Mm-hmm. But when they tell the insurance company that they have sold the property, the insurance company may very likely send them a check back for the portion of the unused insurance
right.
payments.
So the homeowner would need to make a call to the insurance company and let them know, hey, I sold my home, prorate, and you know, send the remainder of the amount.
Right. And then that also reminds me too, Alyssa, a lot of people always ask about their escrow account. Mm-hmm. So if they have a loan, then they're most likely paying escrows into the bank for taxes and insurance. And so they want to know, you know, well, why? What is my payoff? Does it include what I have with my in my escrow account? Mm-hmm. Typically, your payoff does not include what is in your escrow account. And so what happens is the bank then sends you a check back after they've received the payoff and says, okay, here's what you're owed back. So you'll get those escrow funds back.
That's great. It's good to get these checks after you've closed on
it. It's nice, isn't it?
It is.
You're like,
so
now I can go, you know, buy a new couch for my new place.
That's it.
Yes, absolutely.
Angie, what's the timeline usually for that escrow to be paid back?
You know, I just actually did a refi on my place, and I got the check super fast. It was like 2 weeks.
Oh, that's good.
Yeah, I was surprised. I figured I would wait at least a month.
Right.
But I would say 2 weeks to a month is probably a good timeline.
Good.
And it probably also depends on who your lender is. And,
that's true.
Because some payoffs, we do actually, it will tell us that they're including the escrows in that figure. So it really just depends on the bank.
Can the buyer or seller request that?
No, it's just whatever they want to do.
Got it.
No. You know bankers.
Well, yes, I do.
They do what they want.
Do you guys as lenders do like a net sheet for homeowners that have a mortgage? Or what would be your role? Like if I'm a homeowner and I want to sell my home and I had a mortgage with you guys and, you know, I owed you a little more than the value of the home, what happens then?
So let me make sure I'm clear. If you're saying that I owe you, you owe us $100,000 and the house is worth 90.
Let's just say that.
And what's the mortgage amount? Is the mortgage amount be like at like 95,000 still? If that's the case, then you would owe that portion of the money.
Okay.
Now, as a buyer, because the house doesn't appraise at 95, they would not, or a lender for the buyer would not be able to do a loan at 95.
Mm-hmm.
So two things can happen. The buyer can decide, I'll pay that money because I really want the house. And it's a negotiable piece. And the seller would ultimately have to pay the additional money that's owed. It falls on the seller at that point.
So if I'm understanding correctly, if I have a loan as a buyer, right, and the home doesn't appraise, I can come up with a difference?
As a buyer or as a seller?
As the buyer. Can I come up with a difference and
cover that portion?
Yes.
Absolutely. I mean, there was a situation where we had a seller that had solar panels on their roof. This was about eight months ago.
Those are interesting.
They are, because you know what? There's a second lien on the home. And if it's not used for value of the home in certain situations. So that $20,000 lien became an option for the buyer to say, I'll come up with the money to buy it. And here's why. Those solar panels were worth more than that $20,000 that was owed.
Mm-hmm.
So it was an advantageous position for the buyer, and the seller just wanted to get rid of the debt. Otherwise, that would have transferred. Or because they couldn't have clear title,
they
would not be able to sell that home.
Mm-hmm.
So those are kind of situations that not only value affects it, but other things that you do to your home that you have a lien against it that could also
affect it.
Yeah, well, that's a good thing to know. That way, you know, the buyers can still, you know, purchase the home even though the appraisal didn't
come
up to,
And that's on the buyer. If they really want the home, they're going to pay that extra money if they really want the home.
Mm-hmm.
So, and they're hedging that the value is going to come up down the road. I'm sorry. Am I talking too much?
No, you're fine.
I mean, these are things that have happened in my experience,
especially
here because it's been a diverse market.
Do you ever have to deal with maybe penalties on paying off mortgages if people, you know, have owned their home for less than 5 years, let's say, or a couple of years, and now they want to sell it? Is there a penalty on that?
Always. I'm only kidding. If there's a prepayment penalty that you have on your mortgage,
mm-hmm.
then you certainly want to know what that prepayment penalty fee would be.
Mm-hmm.
In today's world, because that was part of what happened in 2007, 8, 9, 10, when the market had its issues, prepayment penalties was a big thing. So now there's rules and regulations in place for them not to be there. But if they are, you want to understand what that payment would be and how it affects you. So you'd have to look at your contract and determine what that prepayment penalty would be.
So most likely the ones that have the prepayment penalty would be something that they bought before 2009 or something?
Not necessarily.
No?
But because there's some what they call non-TRID loans.
Okay.
They're alternative loans that are out there that allow for prepayment penalties.
Mm-hmm.
So if you're in that market, and it's usually for an investment property or an alternative program that's available in today's market. So, but a conventional loan, FHA, VA, you're not going to see a prepayment penalty in those.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do, there's something unusual.
The trick is just know your loan.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
Know your contract and know what you're selling.
Yeah.
So.
The next one I have here is lender, attorney, and agent, how to prepare for a closing. So what happens in your world when you are closing? For us, we just have to make sure buyer and seller have all the documents, all the addendums are done.
Mm-hmm.
We have a clear to close, and we just try to keep tabs on everybody. How about you?
For us, well, when we get that contract, you know, the first thing we do is get in touch with the client and the agent, get the information. Mm-hmm. You know, having the client's address, phone number, email, that's imperative. We've got to have all that information up front from the agent. Once we are able to contact them and they sign a representation agreement, we then order the title search.
Mm-hmm.
So for us, that's the biggest part of what we do, mm-hmm. is review that title search. And so that takes quite a bit of time to do the title search, and so that's usually about a 2-week period. So that takes up a big gap of your closing time. Once we get the title search back, we review it, we make sure that all items are clear, there's no outstanding liens that are not, you know, someone wasn't planning to pay,
exactly.
things like that. There's no items outstanding from a previous owner.
HOAs are all paid off.
There's no certificate of assessment issues, you know, we also order those.
Mm-hmm.
We order pest inspections for clients sometimes.
That's the CL-100.
Yep, CL-100. So we do a lot of ordering. Then we do a lot of reviewing. And then we do a lot of preparing. And we prepare all the closing documents. And we call you up and we say, okay, you know.
It's time to close.
We let them know, hey, we've got all our ducks in a row. How about y'all?
So then what we're collecting are the documents for you to review as well. So we're looking at their income,
mm-hmm.
What type of work they've done. Are they self-employed? Are they on disability?
Mm-hmm.
So we need all the income documentation to know if they can afford the payment that they're looking to buy for the home they're trying to buy. So that's a big portion of the equation for us. Then we verify all that information with their tax returns, W-2s. And in today's world, there's more streamlined processes. So you don't need all the tax returns. If you're self-employed, you definitely need tax
mm-hmm.
returns, because you got to see what they're actually claiming as income. And for people that are 1099, like bartenders, hairstylists, mm-hmm. people in that field, that's another thing where they don't realize that you have certain write-offs that you have because you are in that profession.
Mm-hmm.
So we have to see what their business expenses technically are.
Mm-hmm.
And once we have that information, then we go ahead and we do our get the homeowner's insurance, we order the title, so the attorneys can do their part. We make sure that we give you all the pertinent information that we need, loan amount, interest rates, proper addresses, names, and whatnot, so you can do your part.
Mm-hmm.
And collecting all that information takes time.
Yeah, and you guys order the appraisal.
We order the appraisal.
Just wait for that.
Absolutely. In this state, too, when you talk about insurance and taxes, that South Carolina attorney insurance preference letter is mandatory. So we have to ask the buyer
mm-hmm.
who they're using for their attorney or who they're using for their insurance agent.
Oh, okay. So there's a certain document that
Absolutely.
They should sign saying, I hired this attorney.
It's mandatory. It's mm-hmm. guideline and law. You have to have it signed. We can't move forward without that.
Okay.
So
there's a lot of paperwork when it comes to like lenders, when they're, you know, when my buyers have, are going through, you know, the transaction, the process, they keep saying, well, you know, I keep signing all these papers over and over again. So you guys have like 2 or 3 steps where you're verifying things over and over just to make sure,
sure.
right?
And when you do that and you verify certain things,
mm-hmm.
sometimes they don't tell you everything.
Yes.
So then it opens another door. So then we try to prevent that by looking at them
mm-hmm.
up front. Then we have openers that look at them, and then we have processors that look at them. We try and defeat that purpose, so by the time it gets to the underwriter, they have no clue what happened to get it to them.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't mean no clue, it's just everything was corrected, fixed, and adjusted, and all the mm-hmm. proper papers are in that file.
Right.
For the underwriter to
mm-hmm.
look at, so they can do their confirmation and do
final
approval.
So it goes through a few people before it even gets to the underwriter.
Absolutely. Yeah.
Okay.
And we're relying on the buyer to get their documents to us as quickly as possible, because if you don't, that's going to prolong the process and prolong the closing, mm-hmm. which sometimes, as we know, happens.
It happens, yeah. It happens. And that's why there is an automatic 5 or 10 day, mm-hmm. whatever we pick, for the lender and attorney, because things happen.
Yes.
Right. Now, you guys also do, some loans have like the TRID that you mentioned. Mm-hmm. That's not every loan. That's specific, no. maybe, well, what is it, conventional loans only?
Well, conventional, FHA, VA, you're talking about the agency loans that are out there, USDA. We okay. have to make sure they have the ability to pay the loan back. Mm-hmm. So we go through certain processes to make sure that their income is correct. Mm-hmm. We go through their assets, because sometimes their credit scores could be low. So now we need reserve requirements to make sure that they have, God forbid something happens in the first 3 months or 6 months. Right. You want to make sure there's enough money there to make the payments to protect us as the lender. They're not putting in a lot of money down. So, and when I say down payment money, you might put 3% down. There's 3.5% down on different programs. So that gap, there's a risk. Mm-hmm. And if you're not putting 20% down, which is the ideal loan, so it protects everyone, even the buyer. So there are certain things that have to be in place for less down than the 20% down. Mm-hmm,
mm-hmm. And that document comes out, what, like 3 days before closing, and everyone
the closing
has
disclosure.
To check it? And,
yeah. Okay. And that's because we have to make sure we're not taking advantage of the buyer or the customer. Mm-hmm. And then the closing agent goes back and forth with our closing department to make sure their numbers are in line with our numbers and they have to match. And if they're not matching, yeah. something was missed.
Because mm-hmm. so. If you come to the closing table, all the numbers has to be perfect
yes.
and accurate.
Yes.
Otherwise, the closing won't happen.
Right.
Exactly. And you want the buyers should really know what the costs are.
Yeah.
They really need to know.
In advance.
Yeah. Because you don't want to be surprised with you got to bring $20,000. What? $20,000? You said 10. Well, I was guessing.
Yeah.
And usually the lender would give them an idea, right?
Yes.
Like what you're closing.
They get an estimate
prior
to in the beginning. So. Mm-hmm. And they do a good job of figuring out that estimate and getting pretty close.
Mm-hmm. We do. And you know what? It's only because of the relationships you build with people.
Yeah.
So everybody kind of knows what's going on. We don't have exacts until we know exactly what they're going to put down, what the actual sale price is going to be. So mm-hmm. you kind of...
And it depends on the closing date, too, because the prorations then change, right?
Yes, absolutely.
So then you draft a settlement statement, mm-hmm. which tells them, you know, buyer and seller, everything that they're paying and...
Mm-hmm. With those proration dates in there. Mm-hmm. So if the closing date changes, those proration dates change.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So, and the interest changes
change as well,
based on the number of days.
Right. Mm-hmm. The daily interest, right.
Yeah. And that's when you kind of also tell them what they're bringing to closing, both seller and buyer. This
right.
is what you're going to
sure.
owe this day. This is what you're going to owe. Right.
And that's a good question, because I have buyers all the time ask me, do I bring a certified check or do I wire my money?
That's another one.
I think the best thing to do is to
call your attorney.
And ask them what they prefer.
Yes.
And the question just came up earlier today.
Yeah.
Literally.
For the most part, I think all the attorneys, at least in our area, are requiring wires. We don't do certified checks anymore, mostly because our title companies, the ones that are insuring the title to the property mm-hmm. and are taking some of that risk, they don't trust certified checks anymore. You know, it used to be
really?
That we would only take bank checks, certified bank checks,
yeah,
right.
because
true.
We
I
didn't trust
that.
Personal checks. Now we don't trust certified bank checks because people began to make fake certified bank checks.
Oh my God.
So now instead we're doing wires. And today we're fighting wire fraud. People are sending, I'm going to call them terrorists, because it's funding terrorism, this mm-hmm. money that terrorists are sending emails to clients. If they can get into your email claiming, hey, your wire instructions have changed, send your money here instead. And it has happened to folks. It's so dangerous. I'll tell you now, never, ever, ever believe anyone who says send your money to a new location.
Yes.
They're lying. Mm-hmm. Call your attorney immediately.
Yes,
and that's
no
a red
one's
flag.
Going to
yeah.
call you, right? Not the lender, not the attorney, not your agent is going to call and tell you to wire your money somewhere else.
No, never. Never.
Yeah.
And ask if you can do a conference call to the attorney to make sure you're doing the right thing.
Yes.
That will get them off the phone immediately.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. So.
It's a dangerous world out there.
You have to be careful, yeah. Make sure you're doing everything right. So starting with our frequently asked questions, Georgina is asking about the closing table. Who's going to be at the closing table and when does it happen?
The closing table, right? So your attorney will let you know when it's scheduled for, or your agent. Sometimes we call the agents first and the agents call the clients, but you as the buyer or the seller, only one party is going to be at the closing table along with your attorney. There may be your agent there who comes in support, maybe your lender who comes to support, but it's only going to be one side of the closing. That's the way we do it around here. I guess it's because we're from the South and we like to keep the peace. You never know what sort of things have gone on throughout the process where the buyer and seller may or may not have gotten along the whole time. And so, you know, we just believe that it's better just to keep things separate. Also, we're going to be going over a lot of your personal information. You know, we're going to be talking about your loan, if you have a loan, and you don't want your seller to know your business. So we believe that it's best to keep things separate. And the seller may have another attorney. They may have a separate attorney than you do. And so they will be closing at their attorney's office at their scheduled time. And then we take everything and we all meet at the courthouse and get it recorded.
Mm-hmm. And now the closing attorney would always be the buyer's attorney. They're the ones that actually do the paperwork, do the title, and actually do the closing transaction.
We are responsible for the settlement statement. And so people consider us the closing attorney because we're doing the settlement statement. We're drafting all the documents for the buyer. Right. We draft documents for the seller as well. Mm-hmm. Now, the seller's attorney may have a few additional documents that they want to throw in there, but for the most part, the buyer's attorney is drafting the majority of the documentation.
Yeah. Now, the next question, let me see here what the next question is. Oh, well, this one says closing versus recording. Is there a difference? Now, I've had a lot of people say, well, we closed. Can I get my keys?
Right.
Okay.
So I believe it depends on who you speak to about this one, right? So, typically, I guess our typical stance right now in Horry County, and Horry County alone, because the rest of South Carolina does not take this position, only Horry County. In Horry County, the typical response is you close at the table, it's not your property until it records. And so the reason behind that is both for the buyer and the seller's protection, because for instance, as a buyer, you could close at the table and it not record for several hours later. In the meantime, the seller could go out, get another mortgage on that property, or use that property as collateral and get another lien on that property. And if we had already given them their money, then you would be owning a property that had an additional unexpected lien on it. Yes. You know, so it's really for the buyer and the seller's protection. So to make sure that when we go to record, we do an update, make sure there's no unexpected surprises before we record, and then the property belongs at that point to the buyer. And typically around here, that's when you get your keys. But there is a movement afoot.
I got a question for you then.
Yeah.
Say everybody's happy, right? Nobody's going to do any type of work. But the buyer goes in, and all of a sudden there's an electrical fire. Mm. Who's responsible at that point if it's not recorded?
If it's not recorded, that depends on who you ask.
This is a question.
Movement afoot out there that, you know, once all the parties have signed the documentation, meaning the seller has signed the deed, the buyer has signed their documentation,
and
the money is in possession of the attorney, then it's officially closed. And that should be at the point when all parties should be, the closing has occurred, regardless of whether it has recorded.
Right.
And that's the movement that's coming along around here. And they're trying to get us to join the rest of the world, because that's what the rest of the world believes. We're just a little more cautious over here in Horry County, I guess. If that were the case, I guess, depending upon who you asked, the buyer might be responsible for the issue, and they would hopefully have their insurance already in place.
Now, I'm wondering, if it hasn't recorded yet, how does the insurance look at it? Are they going to cover it?
So the recording, the argument for the closing being the time in which the buyer owns the property is that the recording is not really affecting the transaction. It is simply giving notice to the rest of the world that the transaction has occurred. And it's a valid, legitimate argument. I mean, they're right about that fact. You know, that's the sort of thing I learned in law school. It's just we just typically do it differently here.
Yeah.
So, that makes sense because it's a contract state, right? Yes. So if the contract is signed,
the
and
contract
sealed,
is signed.
Right.
All
it.
The terms of the contract have been met. All the money has exchanged hands right. or is in the hands of the attorney,
right.
which is as good as it having exchanged hands.
Right.
You know, I've got the lender's money. I've got the buyer's, you know, extra money that we're bringing mm-hmm. to the table. The seller has signed the deed.
That,
you know,
yeah, that
it's
happening.
Once the seller signed the deed, then that property, you know, then belongs to the buyer. Mm-hmm. And the recording is really just an opportunity for the rest of the world to know about it. Mm-hmm. And it's a very valid argument. I can get on board with either way. I'm kind of flexible like that. And I encourage my realtors to be flexible too. You know, there are situations out there where maybe we need to do a pre-occupancy. If both realtors don't see the same, don't have the same perspective, maybe the solution is we do a pre-occupancy agreement so the buyers can move in before it records.
Yes, there are some that are extra careful.
Yeah.
And I think it really should go and be up to the homeowner.
Yeah.
Is it okay that you give your keys once you've signed?
Right.
Is it okay that, you know, they move in a little earlier?
Right.
And 9 times out of 10, people say, yeah, it's fine.
From my perspective as a seller, I would say as long as we've got all their money at the attorney's office, you know, I'm good with that.
That's it.
Yeah.
You know,
because the insurance is in effect.
Right.
That day.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Yep. And I'm not going to cancel my insurance until I know everything's done.
Right.
So
exactly.
I'm basically doubly protected by at that point. You know.
Yeah, you have 2 insurances at that point.
So
one somebody's going to have to cover.
So you know, and I think that is if you can remain flexible as a buyer and a seller. You're just going to be more happy when it comes to the transaction and completing the transaction.
My topic of the week is Riviera Village in the Grand Dunes. This beautiful waterway community is located in the most luxurious area of Myrtle Beach. Here you will find elegant architecture, lush landscaping, and the serene views of the waterway. The Riviera Village at the Grand Dunes offers incredible amenities. The Mediterranean-style member clubhouse of 27,000 square feet with luxury dining options, event areas, and gathering spaces says it all. It is an ideal space for special get-togethers. You can also enjoy the tennis club with 10 courts, training services, fitness center, and a beautifully stocked pro shop. There are 2 18-hole golf courses, including a private members and guests only golf course. The Ocean Club is the homeowner's private access to the beach with multiple pools, food service, event rooms, and special occasions. And let's not forget the marina. This is where you can enjoy the restaurants, views of the waterway, and take advantage of the waterway fun activities. From boats, jet skis, and yachts. This community offers the best location, gated and quiet, but only minutes to shopping and restaurants, beautiful Atlantic shores, and the top entertainment spots of Myrtle Beach. These elegantly appointed homes are built at 2,100 and up to 10,000 heated square feet of fine workmanship, with gorgeous outdoor living, pools, hot tub, and outdoor kitchens. Riviera has 64 sites, 12 of which are on the waterway. And most other homes overlook the lakes, golf course, or both. Four homes sold in the last 12 months range in between $700,000 and $1.2 million. Average days on the market is 136 days. Click on the link in the description below to see what's available now. Thank you for watching. Alyssa Lightman here, your host. And until next time, this is The Lightman Show. We'll be right back.